A landslide win in the city of Miami Gardens for a ballot item that gives the city zoning control of that land that includes the city's largest taxpayer, the newly renamed Hard Rock Stadium. Joining us to discuss this and more, the newly reelected mayor of the city of Miami Gardens, Oliver Gilbert III. Mayor, welcome to Issues and congratulations on your own landslide win with 69% of the vote. Now, the stadium ballot item passed easily, but you fought hard with Miami-Dade and the Dolphins to get it before voters. Why was this so important for the city?
Well, it was important because we were incorporated in 2003 as the third largest city in the county, the largest predominantly black city in the state. But they excluded any say-so over this piece of land, and that's kind of insulting. So I didn't understand it. We're a good city with great residents, well-run. We're capable of making good decisions, as we have. And so it seemed that our charter would transition. The county took the position that it would never transition. The Dolphins took the position that it would never transition. So we started to talk about it a couple of years back, and they changed their mind. We came to a compromise.
And why the resistance on that?
Well, I think there was historical. There's history there. Not with this. And I like to always, you know, remind people of that. That the history that led to the initial exclusion had nothing to do with the City Council of Miami Gardens or the current county commission or the current Dolphin ownership or the current mayor. It had to do with a fight with Joe Robbie and the residents of the area about whether the land would actually, the stadium could actually be built there. And so there was a resentment that was built in, that was kind of passed down through the ownership, kind of like a genetic predisposition, and hey, they don't necessarily want you here. And that's not our testimony now. So what we realize is the stadium is something that can bring people into the city. And as we talk about developing and bringing businesses, we actually want the stadium to be used more. We need the stadium to be used more. We want to host world-class events. We want to host concerts. We want to host conventions. So when you talk about the stadium now and that relationship to a city, the beach has water. So they can build hotels around water and restaurants around water and bars around water. Well, we have a stadium. You know, we have a stadium, and so we need to find a way to better use areas like the stadium and areas like Calder to incentivize other economic development.
One time you told me that it costs Miami Gardens money when the Super Bowl comes to town. How has that stadium been in terms of economic development up till today? Has it been good for the city?
Well, they're our largest taxpayer, but for economic development, not really. And that's one of the things, one of the reasons why we actually changed the zoning in and around the stadium to include an entertainment overlay district so that you can actually do more things there. So when the county controlled the zoning in that area, most of it was zoned to either residential or agricultural, which kind of prevented you from actually having real economic development in the area around the stadium. We looked at that and said, hey, we're going to change the zoning, and then we're going to actually allow for more uses with an overlay district because we need that area developed. So when a Super Bowl comes or major events like that come, there's no real place for you to stay in Miami Gardens as far as a hotel. There's no real place for you. There are not a lot of sports bars around stadiums that you see in a lot of other places. Those are the type of things, I call it the natural maturation of a community, an evolution of a city. But those things have to happen, and I think we've taken the incremental steps to try to encourage that. Change the zoning, allow for more uses, make it easier to open businesses, do those things. And we've seen some success. We've seen development pick up in Miami Gardens, some commercial investments.
Perfect. So a little history on the city of Miami Gardens. It sits smack in the middle of the northern part of the county, just to the south of the dividing line with Broward. It was incorporated in 2003, fairly recently. It is roughly 105,000 residents, probably more now, and Miami Gardens is the largest predominantly African-American municipality in the state of Florida. It is home to the Miami Dolphins and, of course, the new stadium. Now, the city is also known for its annual Jazz in the Gardens musical festival.
Yes.
Which brings together all sorts of music, including national, international, local acts, jazz, R&B. Is that the biggest event each year in your city?
That is our signature event, and yes, it is the biggest event. And we've had extraordinary artists.
All right, a little video there. So how does Jazz in the Gardens compare to Super Bowl when it comes to activity in the city?
Well, as far as activity in the city, it's a lot bigger for us and our vendors. So Jazz in the Gardens has It's an outdoor concert that we stage at the stadium, and it really is kind of an interesting story because when it first started back, I guess, in 2004, 2005, it was a small concert in a parking lot that we held for residents. And no one would have ever envisioned or thought that you could turn a small concert in a parking lot into this major international event that people came from all across the country, in some cases all across the world, to be at. And that's what we've done over that period of time. But we have a lot of local vendors who are selling food and goods there. So the music is good, the party is great. The food, you could just go for the food. They had this corn and this big turkey leg, and they had this lemonade. And I don't want to sound like a gluttonous, because people are watching this on TV, but it's an experience. It's not just a concert. And that's what we talk about. We talk about the experience of Jazz in the Gardens. People plan their vacations now around Jazz in the Gardens. People have gotten engaged and then come back for their anniversaries at Jazz in the Gardens. Jazz in the Gardens has really been that thing. It's really a testament to what you can do if you have an extraordinary dream and you're willing to be persistent and work at it. And that's what we do in the city. And so it has a bigger effect on us. It's our signature event as a city. But the stadium is our biggest partner. Hard Rock Stadium now is our biggest partner. The Dolphins are good partners also in how we bring about Jazz in the Gardens, how we do it, how we produce it every year, and how we grow the event.
Let's move on a little bit to politics. You're the mayor of the third largest city in Miami-Dade County, behind Hialeah and Miami. Do you find that your city gets the proper amount of attention and assistance from the county and from the state, given its size?
I don't think so. I mean, I've never thought so, but I think that's, again, when I talk about the natural evolution of a city, 2003 seems like a long time ago, but it really wasn't. And so what happens is those independent neighborhoods, Bunch Park, Rolling Oaks, Crestview, Scott Lake, Andover, Carroll City, the Bajas, that were independent, discrete neighborhoods are now coalescing as a city. And as we coalesce as a city, as we mature, I think we'll naturally reach our political power, because we do have a lot of voters in Miami Gardens. And I think that you're probably going to see that this fall with such an active ballot. You have an active presidential election that by its nature has to engage Miami Gardens voters. And now you have an election ostensibly from two candidates for mayor who are both primarily from the city of Miami. You know, one's father was the current mayor, the other is the former city manager and the current county mayor. So it's going to be interesting, because I think that voters in Miami Gardens can be engaged and they can be educated as to what your ideas are, what your history is, and how you plan on helping us move forward as a city.
Mayor's race, Carlton Manns versus Raquel Regalado, November runoff. Are you ready to endorse in that race?
I'm not ready to endorse, but I know both people. I know both people very well, and I like them both. I've known Raquel since she was in law school, and I've done good work with the mayor. You know, I think that they both need to come and talk to the residents of Miami Gardens, the voters of Miami Gardens, about what's important to Miami Gardens. And I think that sometimes people look at black voters generally and they think of them all as the same thing, and they all have the same interests. That's not necessarily true of Miami Gardens. We have different interests. We want to talk about things like the bringing mass transit, fast transit down 27th Avenue. We want to talk about things like a performing arts venue, helping us build a performing arts venue in the central part of Miami Gardens. We want to talk about things like a CRI. We want to talk about economic development. We want to talk about how we can help build out, how you can help us build out the city. Mm-hmm. Because we have 110,000 people and we have one national chain restaurant, Chili's. That's not acceptable. We have 110,000 people.
That's an interesting measure of economic activity.
Because, see, think about this for a second. If a Miami Gardens resident wants to go and have a meal at one of those restaurants, they have to leave their city. This isn't a town, this is a city, the third largest in the county. They have to leave their city if they don't want to go to a Chili's for a national chain restaurant. If they want to go to the movies, if they want to go to a sports bar, if they want to go to a entertainment venue, if you want to